It's a special honor to be asked to introduce the baccalaureate ceremony for the class of 2012. Graduation is always momentous, all the more so upon leaving an institution with such powerful and efficacious folkways as Chicago. The college has always been a transformative place, and it does this with each generation of students. One generation comes to the university and gains a magnificent education, an education that transforms and enriches our lives, and then that generation helps the next generation, and the process continues up to the present day. A ceremony such as this reminds us not only of who we are and what we have become, but what we stand for. For over 100 years, the college has been a place of vibrant courage and openness to innovation and change, populated by students and faculty who are willing to act on their intellectual convictions. To think about the totality of the education we offer is to think about the most precious gift that we can give to you, our students, a mind enlivened by creativity and curiosity, a person strengthened by self-confidence and confidence in the world, and a life enriched by the love of learning. Our college is all about freedom to learn, not only in the sense of learning something, but also in the more powerful sense of becoming something. President Robert Hutchins put this well when he argued that, quote, what is it that makes the University of Chicago a great educational institution? It is the intense, strenuous, and constant intellectual activity of the place. We like to think that the air is electric, and that from it the student derives an intellectual stimulation that lasts for the rest of his life. And we do live in a university community that values and recognizes intellectual achievement and that tries to create the circumstances that make such achievement possible in all domains of human creativity. As one of my predecessors, as Dean Alan Simpson once put it, the essence of our education is to mix the wisdom of the world with the learning of the cloister, to develop the body as well as the mind, to pay a great deal of attention to character, and to neglect no art that would add to the enjoyment of living. For Simpson, this was a spacious idea which offered every hospitality to creative energy. Anyone seriously interested in liberal education must begin by rediscovering it. The capacity of your university to sustain true academic freedom is hinged on our ability to teach you as our students from the very beginning of your academic careers the value of action that is informed by the thoughtfulness of reflection. Without an undergraduate student body that accepts the authentic practices of academic freedom, the university's ability to, as a community, to sustain our often controversial intellectual traditions would have been severely impeded. In teaching you how to differentiate good from bad ideas, sound from faulty reasoning, precise from imprecise arguments, our curriculum has had a powerful seeding effect in the training of generations of college students in what I would call the skills of a scholar: intellectual engagement, dispassion in the midst of controversy, and the courage to face intellectual uncertainty. A college such as ours is not something to be taken for granted. It is not engraved in nature, and we simply cannot assume that it will always be like we would want it to be, unless we take good care of it. Our distinguished traditions and practices and the extraordinarily talented students and faculty who are members of our community make this college a very special national institution, and it deserves the support of all of us. We have to make certain that our community is as strong and as effective for those who come after us as it has been for our generation and for the past generations of students and faculty who came before us. In fact, we can make the future of the university even better than its past by making the college still stronger in the future. We can sustain our special intellectual values while also building a vibrant community with our students and maintaining wide and sturdy bridges to our alumni. I thank you for your support of the college now, for the past 4 years, and in the years and decades to come. And congratulations on your many extraordinary achievements over these past 4 years. We are very, very proud of you.
Thank you, Dean Boyer. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us in celebrating the memories and experiences of the class of 2012. My name is Edwin Fung, and I'm the chair of the class of 2012 Baccalaureate Committee. I'm extremely excited to welcome you here today and to present to you the class of 2012's contribution to a tradition in the college, our class tile. Our class tile, along with the class tiles from previous graduating classes, are now permanent fixtures in the Arlie D. Cathy Learning Center. Every year, the graduating class designs a tile to commemorate the class's accomplishments and memories. Our tile was designed by Elizabeth Lebling. With the chance to leave a physical reminder of our time here, alongside those of the past classes, the class of 2012 reflected on our experiences in the college and how far we have come. You may recognize the prominent gargoyle on the tile. It's from Cobb Gate, the gates we walked past during our opening day almost 4 years ago, to take our first and only class photo. If you've been on the campus tour, you may recall tour guides explaining that the four gargoyles on Cobb Gate represent each of the 4 years at University of Chicago, with the fourth year on top. The gargoyle gazes out of the gate, looking forward like us graduates as we move on from the university. The lettering in the background follows the design of our class of 2012 t-shirt that we received on the first day of orientation. The lettering comes from an artwork exhibition by Professor Helen Mira entitled Instance, the Determination. Professor Mira took 30 brief segments of text from the indexes of two books on the history of the University of Chicago and the City of Chicago and painted them directly onto campus building walls. They are located in stairwells and hallways in order to be encountered with an ordinary movement throughout the university and are thereby references for everyday experiences. Learning takes place both in and out of the classroom. In its new form, these indexes draw together many of the elements of our college experience, the knowledge we gained, the creativity we used to gain it, and the many campus places in which this happens. Hopefully, this will not be the end of our education and our relationship with University of Chicago and with each other. As we receive our diplomas tomorrow, already packing and preparing for our next steps, let us enjoy and be proud of what we did and how far we grew during our time here. Congratulations to the class of 2012, and I hope that you will enjoy the rest of the ceremony.
King of beasts with quite by one till you shout. Let me sing you off to sleep as you digest. Tonight you'll cock your feet up, but for now let's eat up. Be our guest, be our guest, be our guest, please be our guest.
Do you trust me?
Yes. Point of view, no one to tell us no, or where to go, or say we're only dreaming.
A whole new world, a dazzling place I never knew, but when I'm way up here, it's crystal clear that now I'm in a whole new world with you.
Nothing like Disney to bring us back. It's an honor to be with you all here today. To my loving family, to all our families gathered here from across the world, thank you for coming out. To our incredible faculty, you didn't make it easy. You didn't make it comfortable, but you made it worth something. So thank you for that. And to all the wonderful people I've met along the way, not only did you make it bearable, you made it worthwhile. So thank you for that. As an agnostic, I feel a little like the odd man out, brought up to the chalkboard without doing the reading or understanding the equation. Especially on a joyous day like today, this magnificent chapel, preceding students of real faith, why bring a skeptic? Why bring someone who doesn't know and supposedly doesn't care? I'm here precisely because that's a flawed construction. Precisely because agnostic is too often conflated with apathetic. Because it's not a dirty word. It's a word of compassion and of hope, of freedom and of skepticism, of tolerance and unity. It's a mindset that reflects the uncertainty that grips us all and the inherent fragility that affects us all. Indeed, it reflects the core values of this university: intellectual curiosity, the freedom to question, and the accumulative wisdom of a community. That's where agnosticism gets its strength. Is meaning. Without community, without others, we're lost. Yet it's not enough to have a tightly knit community, closed off from other types of people and closed off from the world. This is the great danger of the life of the mind. It's all too easy to stay within our beautiful quadrangles, amidst the gargoyles, in our Cartesian armchairs, unaware of the world around us. When we go to the world to apply our theories and help our planet, it's essential to remember that we're not all the same. We don't all think the same, and in this comes our strength. The future is as uncertain for our planet as it is for all of us. The world is more connected than ever before and is changing more rapidly than ever before. And it's on us to manage these changes. It's on us to use our compassion, our intellect, our values to make this a planet worth living on. To quote President Kennedy, "Here on Earth, God's work must truly be our own." Acknowledging uncertainty doesn't mean giving up. It means that we must accept those different from us, and it means that we must move forward together. It means that history is ours to make. Go do big things. Thank you.
Because there is no attainment, the Bodhisattvas, grounded in perfect understanding, finding no obstacles for their minds, having no obstacles, they overcome fear, liberating themselves forever from illusion and realizing perfect nirvana. All Buddhas in the past, present, and future, thanks to this perfect understanding, arrive at full, right, and universal enlightenment. Do you think it sounds a little bit vague? I think it is very vague for me. But don't we all love vagueness as we are UChicago students? We love the vagueness because we love thinking and pondering, and vagueness is something we can ponder on. But what is enlightenment? Every Wednesday afternoon, when I sat right here at the Rockefeller Chapel for a 35-minute meditation, that's the question I ask myself. As we are replacing ourselves constantly with a new ourselves right at the next second, new enlightenment replaces the old one constantly too. At UChicago, there may be many moments of enlightenment for you, whether when it is at a class discussion on Marx, Freud, or Heidegger, or when having a dollar milkshake at C-Shop, or when it is 4 a.m. in the morning, on the quad, you and your friends were pulling out a conversation on 12th century Islamic art while there's a paper due 10 a.m. the next morning. Right now, please take a 1 second meditation. Take a deep breath, close your eyes, and ask yourself, what is your enlightenment right now, at this moment? For me, it's the appreciation for this place, where I find myself surrounded by enlightenments. It's the appreciation for knowledge I learned here, the friendship nurtured, and the vagueness I've pounded on. This is a place we got our enlightenments in the past 4 years, small or big, replacing ourselves with the ones who are entering a completely different life tomorrow. And the most important, as we walk into the future, we now have gained the ability to realize enlightenments when we have them. Because we all have been here and have pondered on something really vague, which became clear and became enlightenment later. Thanks to everyone. Thank you, thanks UChicago, for making my years of college full of enlightenment and for making me aware of them. Omani Beme Hom.
When I was thinking about the lessons I've learned from my Christian faith and the University of Chicago these past 4 years, and the way I hope to live when I leave this place, these admonitions from the letters of John and Peter were what came to mind. And for the very dear people sitting in front of me, I hope that they inspire you and cause you to think about how you want to live as you go forth from the University of Chicago to new places, communities, and friendships, as they've caused me to think. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister, who they have seen, cannot love God, whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. And above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Class of 2012, it is my hope that you would be people who love deeply and serve faithfully with the strength and the grace and the myriad of talents that you have been given, and that you would use the education that you have received, the friendships which have enriched you, to go forth from this place and be a blessing and a loving presence to your future workplaces, communities, and friends. I hope that the University of Chicago has given you something that you can offer to the world outside. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Dear friends and guests, it is a pleasure to be with you here today. Coming from the Hindu tradition, I would like to begin my reflection by sharing a hymn from the Upanishads, one of Hinduism's most ancient scriptural touchstones. Lead me from unreal to real. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from mortality to immortality. This hymn expresses a desire to rise from our present condition, the unreal, the dark, the mortal, up to the summit of the real, the light, and the immortal, ideas which are rich but elusive in meaning. As is the case with most of us, I chose to attend this university because the life of the mind that it offered promised a better way to understand the world, myself, and my place in it. Yet, as I reflect on this hymn today, lead me from the unreal to the real, lead me from the darkness to the light, I ask myself, have I come closer to realizing these ends? Perhaps. But I can say that these 4 years have left me with a sense that realizing these goals, whatever they may be, is measured less by what we know than by what we are and aspire to be. A member of our faculty summed up this distinction for me as being the difference between knowledge and wisdom. Knowledge, the basic pursuit of our education and careers, in and of itself may refine our view of the world, but does not necessarily lead to a refinement of ourselves or our character. Wisdom, once realized, offers us no alternative but to change, to transform, and to grow toward greater and greater perfection. It is wisdom which slays us and reshapes us. With college behind us, we know more, but how much have we grown in wisdom? More importantly, as we take our next steps, what can we do to better realize it? These last 4 years have been a time of seeking out who we are, forging our identities, and better learning what defines us. However, perhaps a better question we should ask ourselves is not what defines you or me, But what defines your world? Who and what is a part of it? Now, knowing this, how can you work through your world to transcend yourself? Spirituality is, at its core, a form of suicide. It is fundamentally concerned with dying. By dying, however, I do not mean the inevitable end that we will all face. Rather, I mean how to best live by leading a dying life to oneself, how to empower ourselves to give all of ourselves, to renounce all we have and are for something greater than what we are. But what is this greater something? This greater something begins with our world. In this sense, the spiritual life is concerned with a simple question. How much of yourself are you giving to the people and circumstances around you? By dying to ourselves, we become wise. Through wisdom, we grow. And through growth, we come closer to understanding the real, the light, the immortal, ideas which now seem so inscrutable. As I conclude, I would like to leave you with one question which I aim to keep in mind going forward. In every moment and in everything you do, how earnestly and honestly are you dying to yourself? Thank you for this opportunity, and I wish you all the best as we embark on the journeys before us.
Good afternoon, everybody. Coming from a very religious Muslim family, I found it extremely difficult to adapt to college. Yes, life wasn't that much different from home, but when did I ever have to explain praying daily in my room or what exactly halal food was? I had a confused house in the Shoreland, and what I thought was a kind of boring group of Muslim kids at the Muslim Student Association. I found out that was wrong. It took a while, but through my time here, I've learned to balance my adherence to Islam with various divergences, whether that was what I ate, parties, or, of course, alcohol. Through my time, though, there were two pieces of hadith, or stories about the Prophet, peace be upon him, that resonated with me. Abu Huraira once narrated that the Prophet said that religion was very easy, and whoever overburdens himself in his religion will not be able to continue in that way. So you should not be extreme, but try to be near to perfection and receive good tidings that you will be rewarded. He also said that the example of a believer is like a fresh tender plant. From whichever direction the wind blows, it bends the plant. But when the wind dies down, it will straighten up again. These have reminded me to relax. Yes, even at the University of Chicago, I've been able to relax. And stay strong to my beliefs, whether in academic discussions or cultural divergences. The university has done an excellent job of making campus a group of such accepting people willing to learn and understand about the differences with Islam. I found this through its excellent support of the Muslim Students Association, or MSA. With the university's help, the MSA has made such a welcoming community for spiritual focus amidst a hectic student schedule. And who thought they'd even fund things like barbecues or movie nights? The university has also demonstrated support for allowing me to follow my beliefs by opening full-time halal station in two dining halls. Something that very few people knew about my first year is now in the dining halls, which was amazing. I think that one of the best moments I can remember was a time when a friend of mine texted me really excited to tell me that there was halal food available at Summer Breeze. They were excited for me. So it's because of the support of my religion and the amazing university community and friends that I will look upon my time at the college with fond memories, knowing that the plant, no matter the wind, will straighten up again and that I can relax. Thank you.
Well, I was going to start with a joke, but I saw that Professor Cohen was on the program, and I figured I'd leave that to the experts. But Judaism is, at its core, a religion that cares deeply about the truth, and this care is made manifest throughout the Jewish tradition. This orientation toward truth can be found especially in the works of Moses Maimonides, the great 12th century Jewish philosopher, rabbi, and the author of The Guide of the Perplexed, a monumental work of exegesis, theology, and philosophy that seeks to resolve the conflicts between the literal words of the law and the principles of philosophy. To read the guide is to embark on a rigorous intellectual and spiritual journey in search of the truth. However, the journey leads one to realize that there are some things that we can never understand, some things that are beyond our thought, beyond our intellectual capacities. At the culmination of a chapter about the correct way to describe God, Maimonides writes, "All men clearly affirm that God cannot be apprehended by the intellects. Thus," he continues, "all the philosophers say, we are dazzled by God's beauty, and God is hidden from us because of the intensity with which God becomes manifest, just as the sun is hidden from eyes that are too weak to apprehend it." The most apt phrase concerning this subject is the dictum occurring in the Psalms, "Silence is praise to thee," which interpreted signifies, "Silence with regard to God is praise." Now, regardless of whether or not we've read the guide, we stand at the end of our own intellectual journey, one that has carried us through the Common Core, through our majors, and now out into the world and hopefully nearer to the truth. The lesson that we must learn from Maimonides, however, is that there are truths that we cannot attain, truths that are too big for any one of us. But, and this is the really important thing, this is a realization that we can only have when we, as students, scholars, citizens, and human beings, push ourselves intellectually and spiritually until we can find the limits of our knowledge. This intellectual exercise is what we have been trained to do here, and we must carry it out into the world, for it is only at that moment, when we come to see what cannot be seen and know that we cannot know, that we can begin to move away from mere knowledge and towards wisdom. Congratulations, everybody. Live the life of the mind for the rest of your lives.
The memories that we will recount were compiled from the submissions of members of the graduating class. The memories expressed by the readers are not their own. An effort has been made to include experiences common to the class of 2012. My first time on campus, it was freezing. In late March, I should have known. My first time on campus was, at the time, the best time of my life. I will forever remember Saturday, September 27th, 2008, the day I came to the University of Chicago to start my life at the school I've wanted to attend since I was a child. As I waited outside my dorm early that morning to move in, although I had never met the resident head before, when he came out and saw me, he immediately addressed me by name. I will never forget the surprise I felt, wondering how in the world he knew my name, having never met me. Later, I found out that my RHs and RAs had found all our profiles on Facebook and memorized our faces and names, all in the effort to make us feel welcome. Even now, I think back to my first day at UChicago, and that simple moment stands out. I've truly felt welcomed at the University of Chicago. My first all-nighter was finals week of fall quarter. I was up with some friends studying for a calc final, and I saw someone pitch a tent on the A level. At that moment, I knew that UChicago was definitely unique. My first all-nighter, I was with my friend from my social class, writing our final paper in the reg, eating giant boxes of cereal and pizza from Bartmart, not really getting much written until about 5 a.m., and not finishing until 11 a.m. The papers were due at noon. Spending most of our time bonding, not working. She's still one of my closest friends to this day. My first all-nighter happened because of Cuvier. It was either pull an all-nighter or miss out on the t-shirt. I think I made the right choice. My first all-nighter was first year for a SOCH paper, where I used the cinematic effects of The Matrix to explicate Baudrillard's simulacra and simulation. It was due the next morning, and it hadn't even started. The person I just started dating stayed up with me all night, helping me bounce ideas, keeping me awake, and even helping me edit the paper. I took a little break around 4 in the morning, and it was then, in the kitchen, brewing coffee so I could finish up, we decided to be exclusive. 4 years later, we are still dating.
Skipping class in college became more of a strategic assessment as opposed to teenage rebellion. Skipping class is sometimes good for your health. Whenever it's nice out, the place to be is not in class. It's on the quads. The day after President Obama was elected, Hyde Park was absolutely buzzing. It was so cool to walk around and buy newspapers from corner stores and listen to everyone talking excitedly. Skipping Hume was an absolute necessity. 8:30 a.m., global warming. They never wanted me to go to class. My most vivid memory of the Chicago winters is when I saw snow for the first time and thought a milk truck had spilled in our street. My most vivid memory of the Chicago winters was when I was late for class, so I had to skip breakfast. I grabbed an apple from Pierce Dining Hall. My hand froze as I started biting into it. It was negative 38 degrees Fahrenheit that morning. Enough said. My most vivid memory of the Chicago winters was during the snowpocalypse. I was stranded at the reg when the shuttles had just stopped running. I live off campus, and my friend and I decided we did not want to be stranded all night. So we walked all the way home and took a quick defrosting break at Walgreens. That was the longest, most freezing, and scary 60 minutes of my life. Also, the worst day to wear a skirt. But when I got home, I was so glad that I had experienced the adventure and that I had beaten the great blizzard of 2011. My most vivid memory of the Chicago winters was when I was walking across the quad and drinking from a water bottle. I left the lid off the water bottle, and after a couple minutes, I realized that the water in my bottle had frozen.
My best roommate memories were study sessions integrated with dance parties at the kitchen table. My best roommate memory was when she turns around and says, "So, listen to this. I just calculated my math grade. The derivative with respect to time is negative." We died laughing. When we recovered, she continued, "And the second derivative is negative two." My best roommate memory was probably about 3 weeks after move-in, when the room freeze had lifted. We thought we would never be friends, were the worst roommates ever, and that housing had made a mistake and we needed to switch. But before switching, we had a brief talk and realized we did want to be roommates, or at least we were too lazy to move. And we became the best roommates ever and are still friends. Thank you. Things, and places I will always remember about UChicago. I will always remember 53rd Street. Walking down there when I lived at 53rd and Ellis, the order of the stores and the people I'd see on the street, what the buildings looked like on different corners. Hyde Park was my home, and I hope that in a way it always will be. I want to always be able to come back here and feel that recognition, that comfort. I will always remember how hard I worked, the way people walk through the quad in winter, the way people avoid eye contact in passing, and general what the hell moments that have ceased to surprise me. I will always remember Dean Boyer riding his bike. The campus at the Paris Center, those gargoyles everywhere, googly eyes on the buildings, Tonstoffel, the hipsters, the C shop during Dollar Shake Day, the beauty of the quad when the leaves change, the view from the Logan Center, and let's not forget those 3 a.m. Walgreen runs. I will always remember that feeling that I get when I go into the reg and I am so happy to be there. But also so crushed that I am happy to be there. I will always remember that immense sense of relief when everything is turned in and the quarter is finally done.
So, I realized I was uncommon when talking to friends from back home, or people around the city. I can't bring up concepts from class in everyday conversation the same way I can with people here. I realized I was uncommon when I legitimately enjoyed quantum mechanics. I realized I was uncommon when I figured out most people don't enjoy talking about Marx on a first date. I realized I was uncommon when I taught myself French by watching movies dubbed in French with no subtitles. The best class I took at UChicago was my Hume class with Professor LaBerge, who taught me that you could study anything, even the back of a cereal box if you wanted to. She made the world look like a work of art to me. Everything and anything is just waiting to be studied. The best class I took at UChicago was probably Boccaccio's Decameron with Nathan Tarkov and Glenn Most. Not only was the material really fun, but it was great to watch two seriously amazing professors bicker and joke with each other over interpretations. The best class I took at UChicago was Heidi Coleman's Budgets and Buildings class in the TAPS department. It was like the magic school bus, but with theater. The best class I took at UChicago was every class that dared me to step outside of my comfort zone, pushed me to take risks without fearing failure, and gave me the confidence that now makes me a stronger, prouder person. And finally, the best class I took at UChicago was The Public and Private Lives of Insects. We had a bug dinner at the end of quarter. So, yummy?
The most awkward moment in class is when the professor asks questions and everyone shuffles in their packets, pretending to search for the right answer. Even though it's clear that only a few of us did our reading, waiting for that one kid to pipe up and save everyone feels like eternity. The most awkward moment in class happened one day in a very boring class, I might say. My teacher asked me, "Do you have anything to say about this topic?" After about 30 seconds of honest consideration, all I could say was no. The most awkward moment in class was when my professor passed a note to me, asking me why I did not yet participate in discussion. The most awkward moment in class is when I passed out sleeping, head slung back, sitting in the seat right next to my professor. I first realized I was on my own and my parents were not here when I had to do my own laundry. Nah, just playing. My mom still does that. I first realized I was on my own and my parents were not here when I walked into Hall Gate to take our class photo. It was exhilarating, liberating, and downright scary. I took a deep breath, told myself not to look back, and have been carrying on quite well, actually, ever since. I truly first realized I was on my own when I accepted my full-time position after graduation this past fall. Before college and even during college, I always look forward to someday, somehow, finally entering into the real world. That someday is finally here, and I'm glad that the University of Chicago has prepared me for it. I'm proud to finally be on my own and to have successfully completed the journey that has led up to it.
Good afternoon, everyone, and congratulations to the class of 2012. My name is Dorothy Mangale, and I'm a fourth year here at the college. It is my pleasure today to introduce Professor Ted Cohen to give the Remains of Education address. Professor Cohen has been at the university since 1962, when he pursued his undergraduate degree here. He left briefly for Harvard for his master's and doctoral degree, but he came back. He works and teaches primarily in aesthetics, the history of aesthetics, especially 18th century, philosophy, and philosophy of language. Professor Cohen is famous for his work in humor, which began as a hobby, but grew into an academic pursuit. He has taught on the nature of humor and jokes, as well as on sports, photography, and art. Some of his recent publications include Jokes and the Essays, Identifying with Metaphor, Feeling and Narrative, and Three Problems in Kant's Aesthetics. Please join me in welcoming Professor Cohen.
Too high, always too high. It is a great honor to be asked to deliver this weighty address, and I thank you for asking me. I will get to my profound reflections and advice presently, but first I have a somewhat personal note. As you probably know, tuition in the University of Chicago College is now $43,581. I doubt that you took four courses each quarter, but if you did, that would be 12 courses, and that comes to $3,631.75 per course. Well, as it happens, this quarter, in my two classes combined, I have taught 101 students. As I figure it, for this quarter, I should have been paid $366,806.75. Well, where is it? I have received only the tiniest fraction of that amount. If you can help me retrieve what plainly is due me, I will be grateful. In the future, I may ask students to pay me directly. Enough about me. Now about you and the remains of your exquisitely expensive education. You have spent 4 years among some of the most well-educated and intelligent people in the world. I could be talking about your classmates, of course, but it is the faculty I have in mind. You have been able to learn an enormous amount from the University of Chicago faculty, even if some of them, like me, have been woefully underpaid. But you may well have picked up some items that are not so reliable. What I hope you have learned is skepticism. Not cynicism, mind you, but that skepticism which is a component in all serious intellectual endeavor. Let me give you an example. For many years, I have played pool, mainly with a group of very accomplished scientists most of them physicists, some of them mathematicians, undoubtedly fellows who know a great deal. One day someone wandered into our pool room and asked why lightning doesn't strike boats. Within less than 15 minutes, we heard various theories to explain this fact, but a couple of days later, one of our friends showed up, someone who owns and sails a sailboat, and they told us that lightning strikes boats all the time. So what had we learned previously? Wonderful theories of a non-fact. These illustrious faculty members had offered opinions on a matter they knew nothing about. That's quite typical of the faculty. I'm sorry to say, including me. We are likely to make pronouncements about all sorts of things, many of those things nothing we really know about. Well, where does that leave you? It's up to you to decide whom to believe and about what. It's not an intellectual sin not to know everything. No one knows everything. It may be God. It is a transgression not to know when one doesn't know. Alas, you can't count on people, not even the distinguished faculty at Chicago, to restrain itself. As I said, it's up to you. Now, of course, for you, the internet is a wonderful place to learn things, but it too can be treacherous. For instance, I'm not making this up, there is a website on which you can learn that I am part of a Jewish conspiracy to control the arts in America. Its author is sure of that because I seem to have a Jewish name and I have been president of the American Society for Aesthetics. But also on the internet, you can find a wonderful animated proof of the Pythagorean theorem, along with the quite correct observation that the theorem was almost certainly not proven by Pythagoras. So what are you to do? What are we to do in using these sources of information and knowledge? Well, as I said, you must be skeptical, not cynical, because as the saying goes, a cynic is someone who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. There is value in knowledge, great value, but you must be careful in trying to uncover it. So investigate, demand to know the sources for which it's being claimed. If you do that, for instance, you will learn that there is no Jewish conspiracy controlling the arts in America. Or if there is, I'm not part of it. If I were, I wouldn't be complaining about all that tuition money that has not come my way. Suppose you were to ask me whether some version of Darwinian evolutionary theory is true, or whether global warming is occurring, I would tell you I believe in both evolution and global warming, and I might even tell you that I'm right in those beliefs because those things are true. Fine. The problem is that I don't know much what I'm talking about when I talk about those things. And if I don't tell you that, you're going to have to realize all on your own that I am not an ultimately reliable source. If you then press me, I might, for instance, send you to my colleague, Bill Rimsat, who is a very distinguished philosopher of biology and someone who can tell you about theories of evolution and know what he's talking about. In my long time at the university, which includes my having gone to college here, I've come to realize some of the differences that distinguish parts of the faculty. The law professors, for instance, tend to talk fast and to assure you they know everything about law, politics, and society. Professors in the Department of Economics and the School of Business talk less fast, but they're even more convinced that they know everything. They know everything about finance, economics, political economy, and just about everything else, all of which can be understood through a rather simple-minded rational choice theory. Mathematicians don't talk much at all. But they are sure they, and they alone, know the most important things. And philosophers? Well, we certainly talk. And we are persuaded that we have sharpened our minds so much that we can understand anything, especially because we are not burdened by trivia, like, for instance, the facts. Some of these differences are nicely recorded in a little story. You know, there would be one. The president of a small college wishes to increase his school's reputation, and he asks for advice. He is told that the thing to do is to create at least one outstanding department. Mathematics would be a good idea because it wouldn't cost too much. After all, mathematicians don't need much equipment, only pencils, paper, wastebaskets. But on the other hand, the philosophy department would be even cheaper. The philosophers don't need wastebaskets. Well, so what about you? When you're on the receiving end of questions from someone who wants to know something, well, you could behave like many U of C professors and just state what you think without qualification, whether or not you are an authority, but you might be a little more circumspect and offer your opinion along with a qualification, namely that you are not yourself an ultimate source of knowledge in the matter. In that case, you might tell your questioner that he better check with your old philosophy professor Cohen because he knows everything. Or at least so he says, but don't believe it. Finally, let me tell you that when you've left here, many people will think you went to a public school. Some branch of a university that happens to be located in Chicago, but those in the know will suppose that you have received a first-rate education and that whatever your grade point average may be, it has been learned in a very stringent and demanding environment. This may well give you an advantage. I say make the most of it, because I do know that you have indeed received a college education at least as rich as any in the country. I close with some words from the poet whose visage gazes down from the wall on the second floor of the East Tower of Harper Library. And if you haven't been there to have a look at Uncle Walt, do it before you leave. And what he said, "Now, Voyager, sail thou forth to seek and find." Well, do that. And from time to time, check in and tell us what you know. Congratulations and thanks for listening.
Thank you, Professor Cohen. Good afternoon. My name is Diana Lee, and this is Christian Korper, and we're members of the class of 2011. Before we begin, I would like to ask all members of the class of 2012 sitting in the inner aisles to please look under your seats. There you will find a bag of alumni pins. Please take one pin and pass the bag down the row. Hold on to these pins as you will need them later.
Standing at this podium 1 year ago, I didn't fully understand the true value and uniqueness of a University of Chicago education. It's funny what even just 1 year removed from my undergraduate experience makes me realize. Dean Boyer has time and time again emphasized the idea that there are many great institutions that boast beautiful architecture and impressive statistics. But what sets the University of Chicago apart is our human capital. UChicago undergraduates have a desire to learn and a passion for intellectual pursuits that truly is unmatched elsewhere. And that passion for learning spans every academic discipline. Whether we're experts in these disciplines or complete amateurs, my classmates and I realize that we are all had something to learn from our peers. Our heated debates and discussion range from defining the human experience to inconclusively proving the existence of the number zero. As an alum, I am beginning to understand that the desire to grow intellectually does not diminish with time. Within our vast alumni community, you will find also like-minded individuals who share your same thirst for truth and knowledge. Although your 4 years as students of the college will close tomorrow, your alumni experience is just beginning, an experience that will last a lifetime.
Now, please turn to the person sitting next to you and pin him or her with the alumni pin. He or she will do the same thing for you. As graduates of the class of 2011, we welcome you to our alumni community. Whether you will be in Chicago, New York, Washington, D.C., London, or elsewhere around the globe, you are now part of a network of thousands of alumni. You can stay connected with your peers and forge new relationships through alumni clubs around the world. The traditional alumni pinning is the first step in forging these bonds.
Now, as a fellow alumni of the University of Chicago, we welcome you to our Alumni Association and congratulate you on all of your achievements. We ask that you now please rise, and if you are able, please join in singing the alma mater.
Please be seated. I'm Elizabeth Davenport, Dean of Rockefeller Chapel. Two closing announcements. First, to the members of the Senior Week Committee, there is a gift for each of you, which will be waiting for you at the College Programming Office table at tonight's reception at the museum. Please be sure to go by to pick up your gift with warmest thanks from us all. And to everyone here who is a family member or friend, that means you are not sitting in these first few rows here, please do not try to leave the chapel until all of the class of 2012 have processed out behind their banner. Again, please remain in your places until all the graduating students have processed out and then come outside to find them. You will find them out there. Class of 2012, we celebrate you, we honor you, we are gladdened for you as you savor this time of accomplishment, of endings, and of new beginnings. You have lived the question, in the words of Rainer Maria Rilke, words which formed one of those essay prompts around the time of your admission. At present, you need to live the question, from one of Rilke's letters to a young poet. Now, in Rilke's words in one of the later letters, all that remains is the wish that you may gain more and more confidence in what is difficult. And as for the rest, let life happen to you. Believe me, he concluded, life is in the right, always. May it indeed be so for you. We hope that you will go on living the question, as all University of Chicago alumni must, and that life will be in the right. Always. And I send you forth with time-honored words offered to students at this moment of celebration and looking forward. May the poetry of imagination be kindled in you. May the insight of your reflections ripen the fruits of your mind. May you learn from the stories of the land. May your research empower your descendants. Through the great knowledge of your ancestors, may the sparkle of intelligence course through your life. May understanding rest in your heart and wisdom reside in the depths of your being. Go in peace, go in wisdom, go in joy.